they teach us the ways of peace and hope.
To the very familiar tune of What Child Is This, we sing the words, put hope in each other's hands. Like bread, we break for sharing. Look people warmly in the eye. Our life was made for caring. Hope, hope, the hope of Christ to you, my sister, my brother. Hope, hope, the hope of Christ. Speak hope to one another. Shall we stand as we participate? The words are on the screen.
Thank you. actually, no, you may not. Stand back up.
JK.
Yeah, there you go. All right, we'll see if I can get it right today as far as passing the peace. Okay, peace be with you. Peace. Well, I did it wrong again. Peace be with you. And then you remember also with you? All right, share the peace of Christ with one another. That's right, I know. We're going to get this right, huh?
I think
you may be seated now. Alright, so this is our time of returning to God, part of what He has blessed us with. The offering plates are in the back as usual. You may give online as usual. We also have the second plate back there in the back this morning because with this being a communion Sunday, we typically give you the opportunity to also give to our Good Samaritan Fund, which is the fund that we use to help folks when they come to the church and they need help with groceries or gas or that kind of thing. So if you will pray with me, please. Holy God, we give you thanks for all of our abundant blessings. Lord, we know that even when things don't go exactly the way we planned, that you are with us, that you are leading us, you are guiding us, that you bless us in so many abundant ways. So God, in this season of giving, I pray that as we return this portion to you, that it would be used for the building of your kingdom and that others would know your Son, Jesus Christ. And it's in His holy name we pray. Amen. If you will say- Trish and Rick and their son and daughter-in-law, Jen and Caleb, had a text from Trish this morning that they think Rick probably has COVID now as well. He began having symptoms. He's going to get tested again tomorrow. So continue desires and are there joys that we need to celebrate? Pat? They can sure sense, you know, when we don't feel well or we're discouraged or anything like that. Bruce?
Yeah, I have a couple. Praise the pray for Robert because he found out this morning that Sunday school class there's no Santa Claus.
Oh, yeah, that's right. We do need to pray for him for that.
In all seriousness, I would like to thank Kim for helping fix it.
Yes.
Yes,
thank you both. And there's been so many people that have stepped up in these last difficult months, and I appreciate all of you. And we're going to get it. We're going to get there. We're going to get it. Even if there isn't really a Santa Claus, Robert, I am so sorry.
We're worried about the Easter Bunny now.
Oh, tell him! Then if you will join me as we go to the Lord in prayer this morning. God, on this second Sunday of Advent, Lord, we come with expectation. We come to praise and to worship you. We come with expectation that you are here with us this morning, that your Holy Spirit is leading and guiding our time together. And we pray that all that we offer to you and worship today is pleasing to you. That it's that sweet aroma that wafts up to heaven and pleases you. Lord, as we go through this season of Advent, it is different. It is different than what we expect or what we usually, the ways that we usually celebrate. We know that you are still in our midst, and that's what matters. That you are the Lord of darkness and of light, and that you come this day in the midst of the growing darkness around our world, and you bring light, and you bring hope, and you bring peace. Lord, we pray that you would keep our hearts would slow us down in this season to reflect and to remember what it is in the past and what it is that we have to look forward to. Remind us of the hope that can only be found in you. God, draw us in this morning, and that we might become the people of God that you created us to be. And remind us that baby Jesus is the greatest gift that we will ever receive. Prepare us to greet the one who will lift our burdens and change our lives forever. And as we gather around your table this day, and we are reminded again of your presence with us and your invitation to come and to taste and to see that the Lord is good. Father, we pray for those that are still battling COVID, that are sick, for those frontline workers, for the pharmaceutical companies that are working hastily to create a vaccine. Lord, folks are growing weary. And so we pray that you would just touch them with encouragement and hope. Lord, we thank you for the beauty of this place, for the folks that are able to gather here, that we are able to still gather and worship you, but so many others are not able. So God, be with us in this time. Bless our time together as we bless you and bless one another. And we join our voices as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. chapter 11, 1 through 10, and Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. Hear these words of God. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of power, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. And he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes, or decide by what he hears with his ears. But with his righteousness he will judge the needy. With justice he will give decision for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth. With the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness the sash around his waist. The wolf will live with the lamb. The leopard will lie down with the goat. The calf and the lion and the yearling together. And a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear. Their young will lie down together. And the lion will eat straw like the ox. Now we'll jump over to the book of Matthew, chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. In those days, John the Baptist came, preaching in the desert of Judea, and saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." This is he who was spoken of through the prophet Isaiah. A voice of one calling in the desert, "Prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him." John's clothes were made of camel's hair, and he had a leather belt around his waist. His food was locusts and wild honey. People went out to him from Jerusalem and all Judea and the whole region of the Jordan, confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to where he was baptizing, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance, and do not think you can say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' I tell you that out of these stones God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me will come one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I am not fit to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor, gathering his wheat into the barn and burning up the sheaf with unquenchable fire." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So we've been talking about going on a journey, and as we, when we prepare to go on a journey, we typically make all kinds of plans and preparations, right? We plan where we'll go and what we'll see, and we probably prepare for the stops along the way. And we generally have a pretty good idea of how the journey will go and when we'll arrive at our destination. But sometimes we might get lost, and we might ask ourselves questions about whether we should even be making that journey, or if we should try to go on, or if we should just turn around and go back home. So as we continue this Advent journey this morning, I feel pretty certain that this morning might be one of those that we ask the question, are we there yet? Because we want to hurry up and get there, because as we are taking our journey this week, we are going through the desert. And deserts are never fun, right? But it's also in the desert that we often ask the serious questions. It's this part of the journey that might cause us to ask, is there any point in continuing? What is the point of life? What is the point of my life? It's in the desert that we face devastating circumstances. Circumstances that might cause us to ask, why, God? Why did I lose my job? Why did my loved one have to die? Why is my child rebelling and hanging out with the wrong people? Why don't my parents love me? Why does my husband or my wife want a divorce? Why have we had to experience COVID and the upheaval that it has caused in our lives for the last 9 months? Why, God? And you know, it's all of these kinds of questions that can bring about a feeling of hopelessness. And when we look around in our world today, I don't think there's any doubt that hopelessness is a sickness of epidemic proportion. Amen. It's the number one reason for suicide. And it's at the root of many forms of mental illness and other means of violence. Because when someone loses hope, they are much more likely to engage in risky behavior because they don't feel like they have anything to lose. We all need hope. But we need a specific kind of hope. So when we think just in general terms about hope, there are two types. And we need to not only think of the dictionary definition of the word hope, but especially of the biblical understanding of hope. Because in our everyday lives, the word hope is used in several ways. I'm going to look at least three this morning. Because first, hope is just the desire for something to happen in the future. And when hope is used that way, it's usually something like, well, I hope Daddy gets home so that we can go out and play. Then secondly, hope is the good thing in the future that we desire. Something like I might say as my kids travel home for Christmas that I hope they arrive safely. And then finally, hope is a reason for thinking that our desires will be fulfilled. And those are all good ways to think about hope. And there are uses of that type of word or that way that hope is used in the Bible. The problem is that that kind of hope is based on uncertainty. I hope Daddy gets home early means I don't have the certainty that he will get here, but I desire that he does. And the same thing can be said for the other couple of kinds of hope I mentioned. So typically, the way that we express hope is really expressing something that we desire, but something that is uncertain. But when we look at biblical hope, it's not just a desire for something good. Instead, hope in the Bible is a confident expectation of something good in the future. Biblical hope expects the good to happen, and it is confident that it will happen. So I want us to look at our two text passages this morning for understanding. And upon first glance, we might wonder what John the Baptist has to do with biblical hope. Here he comes out of the desert to bring us hope. That might seem strange as he comes out with this wild-eyed expression, strange clothing, and eating weird foods, ranting and raving about the wrath to come and calling for people to repent. He calls for us to ask ourselves whether our motives are pure. He calls us to ask ourselves whether what we do because of the call of Jesus in our lives, or just because we're hedging our bets. And are we faithful because we follow the one we love, or simply to be seen as faithful? So John's call is to think about our place in this world. It's about the one who comes, how we will follow, and how we are following. So according to John, Advent brings us a challenge. But it also brings us the reminder of our destination, the destination of the world promised by Jesus. So our real challenge then is to measure ourselves by the vision and promises of Jesus, not by the world standards, not by the way the world is right now, to remind us that we are children of God, not of the world. So then on the flip side, our passage from Isaiah brings with it one of the most beautiful visions of hope in all of the Bible while still in the desert. And you know, we always need to be reminded of that vision. But I suspect that we need that reminder a little bit more this year. In the midst of the desert that many of us feel like that we've been stuck in here for these last 9 months, we need to hear Isaiah's word. We need to hear of wolves and lambs living together, of leopards and baby goats lying together, of cows and bears grazing. We need to hear this word of opposites and enemies living together in peace. And we need to hear of this little child who will be a branch from the stump of David's line, this branch that will bring new life out of a dead stump, this branch that will be filled with the Spirit of the Lord and who will delight in following the Lord. What a glorious vision of hope that Isaiah paints for us this morning. So some of you might be a little pessimistic and you might be saying, well, that was a long time ago. How does that help us now? Well, it reminds us that this vision is possible. It tells that this crazy promise, this vision of world peace, the living out of the implications of justice and mercy is possible. And not just in the eyes of Miss America. And you'll get that if you saw Lily's YouTube video this past week about peace. And if you didn't, you need to go home and look at YouTube and see our Miss America. But I get that when we look around the world, we might be saying, how in the world can I confidently say that? So let's go back and look at the Isaiah text again. It says that a shoot will come out. The Spirit will rest on him. The wolf and the lamb will live together. And a little child will lead them. So it isn't a maybe, and it isn't a what if. It's a will. It's a will be, and it's possible because of the promises of God. You know, as Christians, we don't have hope that this will be, because Jesus is our hope. He is our only hope. Having hope anchored in Jesus means that we trust in him and in his promises. And hope is having the confidence that what Jesus says will happen, will happen. Romans 5:13 reminds us of this hope. Listen to what it says. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And the Bible is full of these kind of reminders of the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. 1 Peter 1:3 says, praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus. Excuse me, let me start that again. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. And one of my favorites is Hebrews 1:11. And it says, now faith is the confidence in what we hope for and the assurance that what we don't see is real. Our hope comes from this confidence and this assurance of these promises of Christ. Now, all of this is not to say that if we trust in Jesus, that all of our problems are going to go away. Obviously, we know that that's not the case. This has been a rough year. Likely you're tired. I'm tired. But like so many aspects of our hope, of our faith, hope has to be nurtured. It has to be welcomed. It has to be active. It doesn't just happen. So how do we do that? How do we keep hope at the forefront of our minds? There are probably multiple things that we can and should do. I'm going to share just a couple with you. First, we pray without ceasing, right? When we are in prayer, especially if we are praying God's word, it's hard not to be hopeful. The Psalms are especially good for this because they are full of people that are struggling with problems much bigger than we struggle with, multitudes of problems. Yet, they always have a way to praise God. And we can also remind ourselves of our identity in Christ. We are dearly loved children of God. You are the apple of God's eye. He sings over you. And he loves you enough to die for you. So count your blessings, and I mean really count them specifically. It's easy just to say I am blessed, but what specifically are we blessed for? Write them down. It helps us to remember how faithful God has been in the past. That's where journaling helps, because when you have things written down like that, it's much easier when you're feeling down and depressed to go back and look and remember how faithful God has been to you. That's why the Jewish faith makes such a big deal out of retelling and remembering their story. And we as Christians need to remember our story. And then finally, we praise. The enemy flees when we praise, and God inhabits the praise of his people. So take a walk and praise God and thank him for all of the beauty around you. You know, like in prayer, it's hard not to be hopeful when we are praising God. You know, people are grasping for hope. You may be grasping for hope today. But when we claim the hope that God will keep his promises, the first thing that happens is that we change. And in that change, we become the sign of the presence of Jesus in the world. We become the evidence that hope is real, hope is possible, and hope is alive. When we gather together for worship in order to find hope for living, then we become that hope. We become hope for those that are still traveling through the desert of life. You know, hope isn't one of those things that we can see, but it sure is crucial to our lives. And as I was preparing this week, these are some words from one of my favorite hymns. I wish we had planned to sing this one today after it came to mind, but maybe you can go home and listen to it. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. And then verse 3 says, that he is all my hope and stay. So it's not even just that God's hope is with us, but that he is our hope. Our hope in Jesus is what gets us through the deserts in life. And this journey of Advent reminds us that we find hope in the little child born in a manger, and in the future hope of Jesus coming to receive. restore his creation to the perfect way that he created it to be. So I read a statement this week from a missiologist. His name is Peter Kuzmich. Don't really know a whole lot about him, but I love what he has to say about hope. He says, hope is the ability to hear the music of the future, and faith is having the courage to dance to that music today. So hope is the ability to hear the music of the future, and faith is having the courage to dance to that music today. So my hope for us is that we can go forth today with hope and faith, dancing to the music of heaven as we go through the rest of this Advent season and beyond. And as we gather this morning around our virtual table of Holy Communion, we are again reminded that Jesus comes and he invites us to his table, that we would be nourished and strengthened for the journey ahead and given the hope that passes all understanding. So our communion liturgy will be up on the screen. If you did not pick up your little cup and wafer on the way in, we've got a few back in the back. If you will join me as we come and receive communion as a sign of God's grace. So Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. So hear the good news that Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. So the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through the prophets who looked for that day when justice shall roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, when nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. And so with your people on earth and all of the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to be the light to the nations. You scatter the proud in the imagination of their hearts and have mercy for those who fear you from generation to generation. You put down the mighty from their thrones and exalt those of low degree. You fill the hungry with good things and the rich you send away empty. your own Son came among us as servant to be Emmanuel, your presence with us. He humbled himself in obedience to your will and freely accepted death on the cross. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by the water and by the Spirit. So on the night that he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, he gave thanks, and he broke the bread, giving it to his disciples and saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." So take and eat. And then likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup and he gave thanks. And he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant, poured out for the forgiveness of your sins and the sins of many yet to come. As often as you drink this, do it in remembrance of me." Drink in remembrance of him. So in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith that Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. So pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine that we have partaken. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet.
Thank you.
give thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Couple of announcements and things before we close. We will once again, we will once again try to have our church council meeting this Thursday at 6:30, and pray it doesn't snow or we don't get COVID or anything else that happens, because Paul Bowman is coming from the Conference Foundation, and I hate to have to call him again and change the date. And again, I said earlier, but thanks to all of those that have helped decorate this week. We are planning on having a Christmas Eve service indoors in here as of right now, 5 o'clock on Christmas Eve. And our worship committee will meet next Sunday following worship for January planning. We've been meeting the first Sunday, and that kind of got us off a little during the pandemic stuff. So we'll meet next Sunday and then try to get back on our regular schedule. And before I give the benediction, I don't know if we could still do this or not. I wrote in my notes something else to have, but I forgot to write it on the bulletin. Do we have the video from YouTube? Do we have that or not? Okay, we don't have it. Daryl, we're going to get that up there one of these days. Go home and look on YouTube and look at Daryl's videos then. All right, so receive this benediction. God is bringing light into our darkness. We are called to go into the world confident in God's loving presence to serve others in need. Go bringing hope and peace to the darkened world, and go in God's love. Amen.